Well, I still am glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm glad to be with you all tonight. We welcome those of who have joined us on live stream. Those of you that are traveling, we miss you, but we'll be looking forward to seeing you again. We're going to continue in the Gospel of John. This will be our 62nd exposition of this book. We're going to be in chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, the second in a series on the Father's relationship to the Son. Now, you know this already, but it's good to say it, that the centrality of Jesus in salvation, I say the centrality of Jesus in salvation is established by revelation. This is not an interpretation. It's not an assessment of men, not even godly men. It's a revelation. The pole star of revelation is not the church. That may come as a surprise to some, but that's the truth. It's not even the Bible. And it's not the Christian life, and it certainly isn't the individual. The pole star is a north star. It's the star by which you establish direction. Now, the knowledge of Jesus is where you get your bearings, is where you establish your direction. Theology, which means the knowledge of God, theos, God, ology, knowledge, the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is obtained by a focus on Christ. Amen. There was precious little known about God until Jesus. He revealed some things, but comparatively speaking, there were very, very few. And it always had to do with life here. All the revelation had to do with life here. And so the knowledge of God was largely limited to power and direction, and some had an inkling of his wisdom, but God was not clearly known until Jesus came. God is what we call transcendent. Mm-hmm. He's higher than men are or can get. I mean, you could go to the college for 50 years and give you no advantage at all in knowing God. Yeah. At some point, you got to sit down at the feet of Jesus and learn about God, because Jesus himself said, no man knows who the Father is but the Son. This is Matthew 11, 27. And no man knows who the Son is but the Father. And then no man knows who the Father is but the Son, and he to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Yeah. That's Matthew 11:27. Uh-huh. Well, who does Jesus will to reveal God to? Well, the next verse is, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and learn from me. Yeah. Amen. So Jesus has a propensity to teach about God, but you got to come to him to get it. He won't come to you. You got to go to him. The knowledge of the Lord Jesus, that's where you get your bearings. See, Jesus, he's the foundation on which the work of God and the people of God and the purpose of God is built. He's the subject where to learn. Learn of Christ, Ephesians 4. 20. He's the cornerstone where measures and proportions are determined. He's the shepherd that we follow. I'm showing you the centrality of Jesus. He's the captain who's moving salvation to its intended end. He's a door by which we gain access to God. He's the vine by which we obtain life. He's the bread that sustains life. He's the one in whom all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the day star that causes everything to be enlightened and in which light we see. He's our peace, who's made us one. He's our high priest, who ensures that we can obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. He's the light of the world that makes everything that needs to be seen discernible. He's the resurrection and the life that guarantees life with God. He's the way to God, and he's the door to the new and living way. He's the truth that clarifies and expounds. He's the life that guarantees reciprocity with God. It means you respond to God. God does you no good if you don't. It just isn't that a bunch of stuff is dumped on you and that's it. I mean, the glory of salvation is it enables you to respond favorably to God. And he's the head of the church that directs and sustains it. See, it all begins and ends with Jesus when it comes to dealings with God. This is the word that's come down from heaven now. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. I two times said this audibly, so it was heard on earth. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Second time he said it, he added, hear ye him. So whoever you've heard, whoever you've submitted yourself to, whoever's taught you, you must make sure that the preeminent teacher is Jesus himself. Second-hand knowledge won't get you into heaven. You got to have first-hand knowledge. And the best that any of us can do in introducing people is to bring them to Christ. Like the Greeks came to Philip and said, we want to see Jesus. He said, follow me. So he took them to Christ. That's really the best you can do. And the more acquainted with Jesus, the more you can elucidate upon him. So that's something of what we're going to consider in this text before us tonight. The undeniable emphasis God places on Christ. If Christ is in the background of your thinking, you are not going to get any place with God. That's the way it is. And we certainly don't mean to sound harsh in this. But if you take Jesus out of this scenario, we don't have any hope.
Right.
Not at all.
Amen.
He's the one that saves us. He's the one that keeps us.
Yes.
Right? He's the one that directs us. He's the one that intercedes for us. He's bringing us to God. Peter said he's put to death in the flesh, but quickened in the spirit, that he might bring us.
Amen.
See, no man comes to the Father but by me. That was a while before I grasped what that meant, by me. That didn't mean that he's like a formula. You say his name or something like that. I mean, he comes to Father like you take a child. That's what he means by me. He has to take you to the Father.
Amen.
Why? Because the Father receives Christ.
Amen.
Yes.
And we have no indication in Scripture that it will ever change.
That's
in the
right.
ages to come,
That's
we
right.
will still identify with God through Christ.
That's right. Now, I personally, I think I could substantiate this very, very ably, but I will not do it this time, that the preeminent trait of God is his righteousness. Now, God is love, but love can't save you by itself. You have to have, God's righteous. His righteousness has to be satisfied, and no one on earth could do it. Adam, he flunked the first time. The first time he had to make a decision. This is the only perfect moral person that has ever lived on the earth aside from Jesus. A full-grown adult, morally perfect, or shall innocent would be a better word. And the first time he had to make a choice, he made the wrong one. Why? Because man wasn't made to make choices. Man was made to serve. I know that's pretty tough out of some people, but that's the way it is. Man was not intended, never was intended to be free, as people consider it. There's only two personalities now. You can serve. They're set against one another. It's either the devil or it's God. And Adam, right off out of the chute, chose the devil. If that's all the information we had, we should be able to conclude we got to have somebody in heaven that's standing for us. If that was all we, knew, if the best flunked, what about all of his progeny? What's going to happen to them? See? So what I'm going to establish tonight as best I can is that God needed Jesus more than you did. He provided Jesus more for himself than for you. You're in there. You're in the equation, but you're after that. God needed someone in heaven who had passed through this territory and felt the tug as associated with living in this world, who came out unscathed, someone who would take upon him, who would agree to be cursed and to be made sin, who would agree to that, who would agree to go down into the region of the dead, be there for 3 days and come back. And Jesus is the one that did that.
You were talking about loving the Father, and in the fall, you can't separate the knowledge of the fall from the knowledge of salvation and what it required. But in the fall, Adam did not love God preeminently.
That's right.
He chose Eve. Now, he may not even look far enough to see he was choosing Satan.
Right.
He chose Eve. He loved someone or something more than God. Now, what's the first and greatest commandment? Love the Lord thy God
with good.
all thy heart and all thy mind and all thy soul and all thy strength. And what did Jesus do? He loved the Father and he kept the Father's word. And that's what we need to be brought. This fellowship, this salvation has to do with the heart of man. And it had to be able to change the heart of man to where we loved God first.
That's right. Amen.
Brother Gibbon, I can see where, now you brought some light into that. I can see where the fact that Satan so easily dominated Adam just shows right there that he wasn't meant to live independently from a power greater than himself.
I think I could establish this also. I don't want to spend time on this right here, but there are some things about God that holy angels didn't know. Not the cherubim, not the seraphim, not the four living creatures. There's some things about them they didn't know. They didn't know about God's goodness. They didn't know about God's grace. They didn't know about God's mercy. That had never, to our understanding, had never been, those traits had never been demonstrated to any significant degree before. But in order to save man, these three goodness, his grace, his mercy had to interplay. Now, how do you, and God apparently had a desire for these to be known. Now, how, what's going to enable him to make them known? There has to be a need for them. Hence the creation of man. See, man wasn't a project that failed. All right, our text tonight is John 5:22-23. This is in the middle of a rather lengthy response Jesus had to the thoughts of the people before him who were aggravated because he, according to their tradition, broke the Sabbath day, and then he said God was his father, and that did it. And he's responding to their thought. They didn't say anything about this at this point. They just thought it. But he's responding to them. Here's part of his response. The Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Father honoreth, he that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which has sent him. That's our text for tonight. Now, you'll notice in this entire passage, which is John 5:19-47, one of the most lengthy statements Jesus made, second probably only to the Sermon on the Mount. The prominence of the Father and the Son in this dialogue, John 5:19-47. The Father's mentioned 12 times, the Son's mentioned 10 times. Jesus refers to himself, I, 17 times. The pronoun he, applied to deity, occurs 11 times. His occurs 3 times. My deity occurs 6 times. Himself occurs 5 times. So that in 28 verses, there are 64 references to deity. Now, do you kind of get the idea what the emphasis is? You might be surprised if you just listen now. Now, we live in a time when you can hear an amazing amount of religious stuff on the TV and radio. Now, just listen. Just one day, pick out a little bit of time and listen and see who's mentioned most. And you will find it's invariably man. Of course, if you're going to major on problem resolution and behavioral correction, you're going to be talking a lot about man. But that's not what salvation's all about. So there's no question about where our stress should be placed. Should be placed on Jesus and God. Now Jesus said, the Father judges no man. Let's look at that for a moment. Now, if God was the one judging men, now, there would be no more hope for us than there was for people in Noah's day. God's righteous. Now, God cannot directly himself judge. He can, but if he judges men without some intermediary between the two, he's going to condemn them. I mean, he may form a nation miraculously, give them the only nation that was given a holy and a righteous law, the only one that was given a service, a step-by-step way to serve God. And it didn't change anybody. In fact, they got worse. You can't change people by regimentation. I know this puts a lot of people out of business, but let it so be. Man can't be changed that way. That was in place for like 1,500 years. Nobody was changed. And there were so many judgments from God, you could hardly count them. Sometimes he'd kill, 30, 40, 50,000 at one time. The law was given, 3,000 died. Gospels preached, 3,000 lived. I mean, there's a little bit, so it's kind of a glorious difference there. See, God's righteous. You want to deal with God, and you've got to deal with him. Eventually, we're all going to stand before him. You've got to deal with him. And so it should be a piece of good news that God's made a way for you to deal with him without being condemned.
Amen.
That's what Jesus is all about. Now, the fact that God is too holy to interface directly with men was demonstrated when God brought Israel into Canaan. He appeared to Moses, told him what he was going to do. But then he told Moses, this is Exodus 33:3, I will not go up in the midst of thee, for thou art a stiff-necked people, lest I consume thee in the way. So I'm not going with you, Moses. I'm not going with you. In a direct way. So you remember Moses said, okay, don't go up with us. Please go up with us. And so God made a concession. He said, I'm not going to go up with you. But here's what I'll do. This is Exodus 33:20. Now remember, I'm explaining why a righteous God can't interface immediately with men. Behold, I send an angel before you to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place that's prepared. So I'm not going personally with you. I want to send my angel. But he warned him, don't monkey with this angel. Because angels don't have mercy like I do. Here's what he said. Beware of him. That's his angel's going to lead. Beware of him. Obey his voice. Provoke him not. For he will not pardon your transgressions. For my name is in him. Well, they did. They did provoke this angel. It's a sterling example of what would happen if God personally judged the people. See, this is an index. You've got to see this in accounts like this. If you doubt the love of God and the grace of God, the fact that he worked around this condition, that's your proof that he really does want to save you. That's your proof. Nobody else could address this situation. No one else could do it. No one else could find a way, but he did. He found a way. He sent his son. In order to save us, he had to come way down. The most staggering evidence of humility that has ever been witnessed in this world or the one to come. He stooped down so low. There's no way. He was made a little lower than the angels. This is the one that made the angels. He was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. Then crowned with glory and honor that he might bring us to God. See? He had to come down. Because as he walked among us, he would feel the tug that men feel, except he didn't yield to it, but he'd feel the tug. And he would be able to be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Not with our infirmities. He wasn't able to be touched by our infirmities. Jesus doesn't empathize with your sin.
That's right. Amen.
He doesn't know what it's like to sin. He does know what it's like to be tempted.
Amen.
And if you want to overcome sin, it's got to be overcome at the temptation level.
Amen.
If it isn't, then you just have no altar. You got to confess your sin, and it's got to be forgiven. And if it wasn't for Jesus, that wouldn't do any good either. You can see that. So Jesus felt this. He's now very present help in the time of trouble. You can come boldly, that means confidently, into the presence of God, knowing you've got a high priest there that can be touched to the feeling of your infirmities, and you can, at him, with him, before him, find mercy and grace to help in the time of need.
Amen.
What's the time of need?
Yes.
It's a time of temptation.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know I'm an opponent of all recovery groups. I don't want to apologize for it, but I am. But they can't deal with people like this. Hmm? They got to give them a kind of a mechanical routine. The only way they can do it, some kind of a regimen that doesn't go deep enough. See, it doesn't go deep enough. It doesn't make the person hate sin. But this intercessor we got, he can make that happen.
Amen.
He can make sin repulsive to the person that comes to him.
Yes.
And no one will ever quit sinning on any significant degree until sin is repulsive to them. Till they suffer, he that suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, Peter says. So if sin hurts you, you'll cut out on it, to say the least.
Here's a question you need to ask somebody. Can you love iniquity and love God at the same time?
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
Billy Gibbon, that's kind of a question. You know, Jesus right now, he's our intercessor. He's the high priest. He's standing in between and he's making intercessions for us. There's going to come a time when we're going to be present with the Lord.
Yeah.
God himself is going to be with us.
Yeah.
So this intercessorship, as far as sin goes, will not be in place as it is now. At least that's my understanding.
Oh, no.
Because there'll be no need for it.
Yeah, you won't see now. Sin is actually localized in when you're in Christ. Sin is localized in your body. The body is dead because of sin. See that?
Yeah.
That's where it. As long as you got this body, you gotta wrestle with sin. But in the resurrection, everybody's getting an incorruptible body.
That's right. Yeah.
Now that's going to be hell for people that are not saved.
Yeah.
Because they are going to have a redeemed body and an unredeemed spirit, which means they will never one time be able to do anything they want.
Mm-hmm.
Never.
Yeah.
They're going to be trapped in a body that can't sin, and all they want to do is sin.
Uh-huh.
They cultured it. See, hell doesn't make people not want sin.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Nobody repented that went to hell.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The rich man didn't repent.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, he was concerned about his brothers, you remember.
Yeah.
But he couldn't be changed. And he wasn't there until he found out baptizing was the thing.
Yeah.
He said, send Lazarus to dip his, his finger. Yeah, he's baptized. Dip his finger. And he wanted Lazarus to come where he was. He didn't ask Abraham to let him come where Lazarus was. See why? Because that place was just as repulsive as where he was.
Yeah.
So anyway, Jesus can deliver a person from that dilemma so that your best experience will be after you leave the world. So Jesus is able to be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. But there's no allowance for provoking Jesus. And Jesus can be provoked. When he was on earth, there were some people that provoked him. And he really unleashed some diatribes against him, like scribes, Pharisees, lawyers, people like this. So, but you don't want to provoke Jesus because he's your way out.
Amen.
He's who God has provided. Now, you may wonder about people that died before Jesus. How are their sins going to be remitted? Well, when Jesus died, the effectiveness of his death reached backward.
Yes.
As well as forward.
Yeah.
See, it was a thorough. He took all sin away.
Yes.
All sin of all time was gathered together into one composite whole and laid on Christ. The impact of that upon his spirit is beyond our imagination. He had never one time felt the defilement of sin. Not a single time, not when he was 2 or 6 or 12 or 30. He never had felt the contamination of sin. And now in a moment of time, All the sin of the world is placed upon him, and the impact of that upon his spirit is, I can't take it in. That's what sin cost him. So if he asks you for it to cost you something to quit sinning, you shouldn't complain about it.
Amen.
You should just pay the cost to go on your way rejoicing. Amen. If he says, don't sin, then resolve, I'm not going to sin. He'll give you the resource.
Yes.
It all depends on how close you live to him. All depends on how much you're living for the Lord, and how much you're walking by faith and living in the Spirit. It all depends on that. But there's a way out of this dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is the one. Now Jesus says, yes.
Your comment there on the weight of that sin, typically men are prone to think about what they would think are the really bad things. And there are some very bad things.
Mm-hmm.
But you think about any sin will condemn you to hell. Any sin.
That's right.
Now the weight of sin looks even heavier.
That's right. Yes, any sin, no matter how minuscule, has the potential of sending you to hell.
Yes. Right.
Unchecked.
Uh-huh.
I mean, how, eating a piece of fruit?
Yeah.
That one time.
Yeah.
They didn't like do this every day for a couple of weeks. They just did this one time, one fruit, one time. It shows you that sin, the frequency of sin, is not the thing that enslaves people. If you commit sin, Jesus said, you are the servant of sin. Sin is an enslaver.
Amen.
It also shows that the act itself
is
not all there is to it.
That's right.
There are things that in and of themselves are legitimate.
Yeah.
And yet they can be made sin. It's a much deeper problem than just, you know, the plowing of the wicked
is sin.
Is plowing sin in and of itself? No.
Yeah.
But see, there's an element of wickedness that is associated with all sin.
Yeah.
Everyone who sins at all in any way requires a Savior.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Again, I'm explaining here why all judgment has been given to the Son. It's because God is preeminently righteous and holy.
Yes.
And saving people has to be a righteous thing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If salvation isn't righteous, God won't save anybody.
Yeah.
The salvation itself has to be righteous.
Mm-hmm.
That he might be both just and the justifier of him that believes in Jesus. So it has to be right for God to save you. You can't make it right. Jesus did make it right. See? That's why we're talking about this. All judgment has been committed unto him. See, any dealings with God have to be through Christ. Even the day of judgment, in order to give us the greatest advantage, God's going to judge us by that man whom he hath ordained, and that he has given assurance unto all men, and that he has raised him from the dead. So that's why Jesus is going to judge us. That will give us the greatest. Can you see that? That will give us the greatest advantage. So that people that are reconciled to Jesus, they'll make it through.
Amen.
They'll have boldness in the day of judgment. Scriptures refers to.
Jesus is the one that died for sin.
That's right.
So he's going to be the one that's going to be rise up to the top and be the one to give repentance to men.
Yeah.
That's good.
And I don't want you to overlook this, that if God judged you directly himself, you wouldn't have this advantage.
No.
But he's not. He's going to judge you through Christ because God's not looking for a reason to condemn people.
Amen.
That's not what God wants. That's not what drives God, is not a desire to condemn people. Although he will, in the end, there are going to be people condemned, but not because God wanted it.
Amen. Yeah.
Because they rejected his provision. So that's why judgment has been committed to the Son. The Son would make it righteous for God to save sinners. And I thank God for it.
Yes, amen.
See, because he will transform them. He'll recreate them. God couldn't do anything more with Adam. Mm-hmm. So Adam and his entire race was written off right there in the garden. Written off, for they were expelled from the garden, they were written off. That's when Adam all died. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There had to be a new race, had to be a new progenitor. And Jesus is a head of a new race. That's, now who would have thought that that'd be the answer to sin? A recreation. But the fullness of this is not going to be seen until you're on the other side. Romans 3:25 makes a statement that has long intrigued me. It says that God set forth Christ to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his, God's, yeah, his righteousness for, yeah, the remission of sins. Yeah. He's righteous for God to forgive the sin of a person who trusts in Christ.
Amen.
He's righteous. But if you just want to go by the letter of the law, you couldn't prove that. You got to go by the nature of God.
Yeah.
God is not only righteous, he's wise. And so he saw this situation. Didn't take him by surprise, as you must know.
Yes.
And he provided a way to undo what Satan did.
Amen.
Marvelous. Now God been, until that time, until Jesus came, God was forbearing. He winked at sin. It looked like he didn't pay any attention. It looked like he didn't know what was going on, but he just winked.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Compared to eternity, it was just a, you know, just a wink. But the time of winking is over.
Yeah.
He's not winking at sin anymore.
Yeah.
Now he commands all men everywhere to repent.
Mm-hmm.
Now here's a great kingdom secret that the moral strategists, mm-hmm, have missed.
Mm-hmm.
The answer to enslavement to sin. Mm-hmm. Take that addiction, take that out, because there's not personal responsibility in addiction.
Mm-hmm.
But enslavement to sin is personal responsibility.
That's right.
The answer to enslavement to sin is repentance.
Amen. Yep.
It's not routine.
Yep.
It's not steps. It's repentance. And when you repent, God comes into the situation. Yes, sister.
Yeah, because it's been brought out before. Repentance means turning around.
That's right.
From that. And, Some of the groups that do this, they teach people to say, I am an alcoholic.
Yeah.
So that it's like they continue to be that,
yeah,
instead,
yeah,
of changing it.
That's,
you know,
right,
what I'm saying?
But yes,
it's like,
I know what you're saying.
Their mindset is like, I'm really this, but I'm trying not to do,
yeah,
this. But really, you can repent, and the Lord gives you power. He changes you so you're,
that's
not,
right,
that person anymore.
Yeah, we acknowledge that. When you're saved, did you have something to say, Sister Tanya?
Gonna say, I mean, the Lord is the only one that can help you let go of that old person,
mm-hmm,
that you were.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now we,
mm-hmm,
we acknowledge that what you were, part of that still with you. It's the old man. See, this is the complicating factor. You are in Christ. You're a schizophrenic. You're two people. You're not one person. You consist of an old man and a new man. Your job is subdue that old man. Keep him on the cross. Crucify. Now the cross is a slow death.
You're either all in or you're not in at all.
That's right. That's right. And if you keep the flesh on the cross, the old man, if you keep him on the cross, he'll eventually die. But if you let him off, he's just as strong,
yeah,
as the,
right,
day he was put up,
yeah,
there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But some of us learn that the hard way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, flesh doesn't lose its power.
Yeah.
So you nail it to the cross. Now you begin when you're baptized into Christ. God puts him on the cross for you. It says flesh was crucified. He tells you that the old man was crucified when you died with Christ.
That's
so,
right,
he put him up there for you.
Yeah.
Then he tells you, keep him up there, and he gives you all the resources necessary to keep him up there. The grace of God will teach you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust, to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present evil world. See, he gives you all the resources to do it. But Satan goes to work over here to get you to allow that crucified nature off the cross. To kind of learn to live with him with a little activity. But see, he's not content with a little activity. You let him off, and he'll do the worst in a short time. Well, repentance, remember, is the answer to sin. And Jesus has been exalted, Acts 5:31 says, to give repentance to Israel. And the Gentiles are included, because when Peter reports the conversion of the Gentiles, the early church said, God has given them repentance.
That's right, yeah.
That's not what people say today. At least some of the people I've known. That's not what, you report a conversion, I don't hear people saying, God's given them repentance. No. But that's what really happened.
Amen.
Why did he do it? Because of Jesus.
Amen.
He exalted Jesus. Jesus can get repentance into you.
Mm-hmm.
He can do it.
Yeah.
Been exalted to do it.
That's because salvation, Christ dying on the cross, didn't change God.
Yeah.
It changes us.
It changed us.
Jesus gives us to repent, which changes us. We're changed into a new creation.
Yeah.
So God doesn't change. It's we're changed, and so He loves us.
That's
the word
right.
Christ.
That's why we had to be changed, because God can't change. He told us, I, the Lord, I am the Lord, I change not. See, He's revealed, I don't change.
Yeah.
I hate sin just as much as I ever have.
That's right.
But He's done something now that has neutralized the impact of sin.
Amen.
All right, so he judges no man. He committed all judgment to the Son to give an advantage that we can take hold of so we can get out of this dilemma. That all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. Now these are the words of Jesus. And it's this long discourse that we're wading through here. Honor the Son. That means that it's imperative that people know who Jesus is.
Yeah, amen.
Mm-hmm. As God has defined him. Not as men have defined. There is an enormous amount of activity in our time during which the whole face of Christianity has changed. In the last 40 or 50 years, it has changed at the root level. It's changed. But God hasn't changed. Jesus hasn't changed. And the true identity of Jesus has got to be known. If Jesus can induce God to bless sinners, that same Jesus can induce sinners to stop sinning.
Amen.
Amen. What's wrong with that? Why do people resist that? Say, well, you know how we all are. No, that's not. Yeah, we do know how we all are. That's why we have a Savior.
Yeah.
We should say we know how Jesus is.
Yes.
The point isn't for you to know you. Uh-huh. That could be kind of depressing.
Yeah.
It's for you to know Christ.
Amen.
This is eternal life, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, and thou sent.
Yeah.
That's what eternal life is.
Mm-hmm.
The closer and more knowledgeable, the more working understand you have of God, the more alive you are.
Yeah, that's right.
Why? Because that's the effect God has on people.
Like stuff that the world will tell you too, that, you know, if you love yourself more, then you can love others better.
Yeah.
You know, which is such baloney. If you love the Lord, then
yeah.
The rest comes along.
Baloney. Yeah, a lot of meal in it. Yeah, I've heard that. There are people, yeah, I've heard that myself. You gotta love you. But see, the scripture says no man ever yet hated his own flesh, so there's no such thing as a person that hates himself.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I don't like myself. That's just talk. That's just jabber.
Yeah.
But even that kind of talk
is someone seeking to find their meaning or purpose in something that's really quite apart from God. They're still seeking that apart from Him.
Apart from God,
yeah.
It
becomes this black hole that doesn't have...
Yeah.
It's not filling them at all.
Mm-hmm.
Or anybody else.
I want to focus attention on this word, that. He committed all judgment unto the Son, that. We might say, in order that. As this is the reason why God committed all judgment unto the Son. What he's going to say is the reason why he did that. Mm-hmm. So that all men might honor the Son as they do the Father. See? In other words, Jesus brought the Father down, so to speak,
yeah.
into our perception.
Amen. Yes.
So we could yield to him. See, he was there was too big of a separation. There was too large of a separation for men to handle it.
Yeah.
So he gives all judgment to the Son, which makes the Son accessible to men, which enables men to give honor to the Son, see?
Uh-huh.
But men weren't given the honor to the Word before he became flesh,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Right? Men weren't honoring him. Angels and cherubim probably did, but men weren't honoring him. But now when he came down, humbled himself, came down, that's why he gave all judgment to the Son. So men who didn't know enough about God to really honor him, would see the Son, be attracted to him, and honor the Son, and that would count as honoring God.
Amen.
Now there's no eternal benefit to anything that has had its genesis with man. Yeah, I mean, there are programs that are hawked and sold, marketed to say this will guarantee that you do this and that, in the realm of religion I'm talking about. But anything that had its genesis with man cannot be effective in anything pertaining to God, life, or godliness. You've got to know that. You must know it. If that wasn't the case, then Jesus wouldn't have come down. If Jesus could really work, if God could really work with some of these plans, he would have dispensed with sin in Jesus and just worked with these plans. That say that give you more grace, give you be able to conquer. You follow our methodology and you'll have the victory. See, if they really did work, then there's no need for Jesus.
That's right.
In order that. And it's all men, that all men should honor the Son. That's everyone or all people. No one's excluded. All of Adam's offspring. This includes every race, all Jews, all Gentiles, all men, all women, all children, all husbands, all wives, all masters, all servants, all government officials, all armies, all citizens, all buyers, all sellers, whatever class they're in, they should honor the Son.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
See? So you can't set up a social structure where some people are subject to other people and they do only what the other people say to do.
Uh-huh.
That may sound smart, but it's not smart.
Yeah.
You can't interfere with this that all men should honor the Son.
That's right. Yeah.
That's got to happen. Or the benefit of salvation is not going to be realized, experienced. They should do that. That's not an option.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, some versions, they're very sloppy in handling this. These men are masters of etymology, but not of the knowledge of God.
Right.
Mm. Contemporary English version reads, the Father wants all people to. I don't doubt that God does desire this heaven, but this is not... Jesus didn't go through this so God could want people to be... That's not why.
Mm-hmm.
It's so that people should.
That's right.
Amen.
The fact that Jesus died makes it unlawful and a sin not to pay attention to the Son.
Amen.
It's wrong.
Yep.
It's wrong.
That's right.
And you no man has the right to have a wrong view of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody. If it is, it's another Jesus.
Amen.
That's not the real Jesus. So some of these translations are rather sloppy. All men should honor God, and they should honor the Son as they honor God. Now, when they did not, they were before Jesus. When they did not, they were summarily judged. God asked Israel, and he'd worked with Israel for 1,000 years. 1,000 years. Led them, he fed them, he gave them victories, you know, he nurtured them, chasing them so they'd wake up. And he asked them in Malachi 1:6, "Where is my honor?"
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Do you think he's not saying that to our generation? Shouting it from heaven, "Where is my honor?" Now we're at a time we're going to have an election pretty soon. God's not being honored most of the time. I think God would say, "Look, I told you that Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. How come you're holding caucuses on who to vote for instead of storming the throne?" How come people have forgot that God's the governor among the nations?
Yeah,
huh? Why has that been forgotten? Because men aren't honoring the Son.
Amen.
That's why. They should honor the Son. They should. That is, it's incumbent that they do it because God's given all judgment to Him. If there's anyone you want on your side, it's Jesus.
Amen.
All judgment's been committed to Him. One through whom mercy as well as judgment can be expected. He's one through whom mercy as well as judgment can be expected. Honor the Son means to... Here language kind of breaks down. I mean, word studies are nice, but they're not... You've got to have some discernment. Honor the Son, that's esteem Him, respect Him, give honor to Him. Most versions do say honor. Etymologically, the word honor means to respect or revere, venerate. On the Lord's Day, you find out who venerates the Son.
That's right.
Oh, I understand. People got their explanations.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But there's a table of remembrance.
Yeah.
The table of the Lord is called. You can't eat at this table and the devil's table.
Yeah.
You can only eat at one table at a time. Some congregations, we don't sit in judgment on them, but God does, have elected to ignore this table. Some people have the table, but they talk like babies at it. I can't begin to tell you the terrible meditations. Well, I wouldn't dignify them calling meditations. The terrible words I've heard said at the Lord's table, and most of the prayers you couldn't even hear. That's not honoring the Son. A visitor comes into a congregation, they should see what's going on at this table. You don't sit in the back of the building someplace where it can't be seen. The Son's to be honored. And this is one place where I'm telling you is that the way God set up assembling was so you'd honor the Son.
Amen.
That is an aspect of honor also, to set forth as prominent.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
Remember me.
Well,
I've heard dissertations on everything from government to you name it at the Lord's table, but this is His table.
That's right. And they did meet on the first day of the week to break bread.
He honored Him. All men should honor the Son as they do the Father, all right? This means that the Muslim view of Jesus is wrong.
That's right.
They say Jesus is just a prophet. He's not even the prophet. He's just a prophet.
Yeah.
They don't honor the Son. This means the Mormon view of Christ is wrong. They hold that Jesus is a created being and that Lucifer is his brother. Oh, yeah. You see, well, I didn't know they believed that. Well, spend some time and find out. This is what they believe. The Christian Science view of Jesus is wrong. They believe his blood did more good in his veins than it did upon the cross. See, though there are some completely erroneous views of Christ that's out there, we've got some new ones, like Jesus wants you to be wealthy and healthy. Is this why Jesus died, so you'd have more money? Is this really why Jesus... Well, God could have given you a lot of money without Jesus. Solomon's day silver is just like dust, like dirt. Yeah, but he didn't have much morally.
That's right.
The longer he lived, the worse he got. You can have all the wisdom of the world, which was what Solomon had. He had all the wisdom that you could get concerning this world. He was an expert at anything having to do with this world. And he sank like a moral rock. Why? You don't have to learn this the hard way. You do not have to learn this the hard way. God set Solomon up, in my judgment, to show us you can have every bit of knowledge this world has to offer and not even get off first base.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
He set up Job to show you how much a person can suffer and not deny Christ. And you can learn from these people that had epochal experiences from God. They're intended to teach us something of God. So all men are to honor the Son as they honor the Father. See, this presumes they're honoring the Father. If they're not honoring the Father, the Son doesn't make any difference. The Son will just judge them, that's all. An unholy life reveals a lack of honor for Jesus. Enslavement to sin, it reveals a lack of honor for Jesus. The prevalence of self, that reveals a lack of honor for Jesus. And we're living in a society that allows people not to honor Jesus. In fact, it's kind of encouraged. In spite of that, God has made provision so that men can honor the Son. In other words, he's put the Son within their reach. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. See, God came down in the person of Christ within our reach.
Amen.
Before that, the knowledge of God was largely theoretical unless God had revealed something, and he didn't reveal a lot about himself to the people. Then Jesus adds, in case there's any question about it, he that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which has sent him. So there's no such thing as someone that loves God and serves God but doesn't believe in Jesus. There's no such thing as this. God will not receive service from somebody that doesn't honor the Son.
Amen.
His house is going to fall. Jesus said, if a man hears these sayings of mine and doesn't do them, I'll tell you what he's like. He's like a man that built his house on the sand. The winds came, the rains descended, the floods came, and that the house fell, and great was the fall thereof, which meant it couldn't be rebuilt. Great was the fall thereof means he didn't go back and start again. See, everybody who tries to build a good life, and they do it without Jesus, they're wasting their time. The results of their work are going to fall. If they don't fall before they die, they'll fall when they die. So who is the person that doesn't honor the Son? It's the person who hears what he says but doesn't do it. They choose a convenient religion that allows for them to keep their natural preferences, see? The truth of the matter is they have usurped the position of Christ. Not effectively, but for themselves, they've usurped it. As soon as the spotlight's on you, you get blind. That's what happens. It's to be understood that honoring the Son postulates an interface with eternity.
Yeah.
That's why you read things like, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. See? That's why those things are in Scripture. Your association with God enables you to interface now with eternity. Our conversation is in heaven, from whence we look for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You're living for there.
Yes.
You're laying up treasures there. See? You're seeking a city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. You're seeking a better country. See?
Yes.
You're the locus or center of your life is there,
Amen.
Not here.
Amen.
And those who take advantage of this will testify to you. This is sustaining. You can live in a terrible world and have an excellent attitude. You can do it. Because you're honoring the Son. See, the Son, if you honor the Son will reciprocate.
Yes, amen.
He's a good shepherd. He leads you by still waters. Restore your soul. Lead you into green pastures. See, he'll reciprocate. If you give honor to him, he'll reciprocate. That won't be in vain. So whatever you have to do to honor the Son, and this is part of working out your own salvation, fear and trembling, there is no methodology on how to honor the Son. Mm-hmm. And no other person can do this for you. You've got to work out your own salvation, fear and trembling, and how it's got to end up is you honoring the Son like you honor the Father. In other words, what Jesus tells you, you take it as from God. What Jesus does for you, you take it as from God.
That's right.
Let's say something.
Yeah. If you refuse anything that Jesus is or said, that's dishonor.
Dishonor. That's right.
So you do that. Honor is a big word. To receive him, that means to take hold of and to. To not set at naught or to set anything against it where it's exalted above that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is honoring the Son. And you mentioned some of these other religions. None of them have the God of Scripture.
Yeah.
None of them. You mentioned specifically the Mormons and the Muslims. Mm-hmm. But there is not any religion among the sons of men that do not have the Christ that is set forth in the Scriptures, that really know who God is. Now, how can you honor God in ignorance?
Yeah, amen.
So, amen. I mean, a person might be groping, but they, as long as they're ignorant, ignorance is a separation. And you have to have the Son to bring you to the Father.
Amen. And we're alienated from God, from the life of God, by the ignorance that's in us. Ephesians 4:18. Yes. Now let us consider at this point the church, which is the body of Christ. That is, as Jesus expresses God, the church expresses Christ.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's how it works. If the church doesn't express him, he's not going to be expressed.
That's right.
He's not going to speak out of heaven like he did at Sinai, like he did at Jesus' baptism, like he did at the grave of Lazarus, like he did at the Mount of Transfiguration. He's not. The church is the pillar and ground of the truth. It's the custodian.
Amen.
If the church doesn't tell the people what God requires and what Jesus has done, the people can't read their way into it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Sometimes I'm concerned. I know that I'm for everybody having a Bible. Understand. I'm certainly not opposed to that. But that's not the answer. I mean, what are you going to do if a fellow reads the book of Leviticus and start offering up lambs because that's in the Bible? And you can't find in the Bible a prohibition against circumcision. So they say that they start observing it like, all right, how are you going to convince a person like that that's not what you do?
Yeah,
You got to have somebody who knows God.
Amen.
Has to expound these things to the people.
Amen.
If you've ever traveled abroad and come across Christian people, some of the craziest ideas you ever heard in your life are among Christians that are in foreign soil.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Some of them were imported from our fair country, I understand, but...
Yeah, he does ask the question, how shall they hear
without a preacher? Without a preacher, yeah. Somebody who knows has to expound God.
Right.
Jesus is the ultimate one that knows, that expounds God.
Right.
So Jesus teaches us. We know the Son of God is come and has given us an understanding that we might know him that is true.
Yes.
And we are in him that is true, even his Son Christ Jesus. This is the true God.
Amen.
The one Jesus taught you about.
Yes.
And Ephesians 4:20 says that ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that you have been taught by him.
Yeah.
Well, the Ephesians, Jesus never taught in Ephesus. They didn't have personal contact with Jesus. Jesus taught them from heaven.
Amen.
Yes.
Well, I was going to say, there was a time when I thought it was a thing to make sure everybody had a Bible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we give cases of them away.
Oh, yeah.
But that's a good place to start, but really, the church, it's been given to the church to be the expositor of the truth. Like
yeah.
You said, the pulling ground of the truth.
I would say, I'm not against distributing Bibles, God forbid. But the ideal is you got to send someone that can tell them what the Bible means.
Yeah.
He has to be an expounder of Scripture. That has to happen.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's what prophets were in the Scripture.
Yeah.
They spoke unto edification, exhortation, and comfort. They caused the truth of God to make sense to the people.
Amen.
Yes.
Scripture alone would have done it,
then
the eunuch would not have needed Philip.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's
there
right.
You go. Yeah. He was confused.
He was reading.
That's
God,
right.
God sent Philip.
So that's what. Now that scenario would be right. A person who was diligent and read, he'd be confused
by
things Scripture said.
Yes. Yeah.
But if a heart was longing, God will say, there'll be someone say, come over into Macedonia and help us.
That's right.
Yes.
Whenever there's somebody that's genuinely seeking the Lord, he would be unrighteous to not send somebody.
That's right.
Yeah.
And we know that God is not unrighteous.
That's right.
When
Amen.
He told us, those who seek shall find.
That's right.
And he will.
Now, the church is the pillar and ground of the truth. Wherever there are redeemed people, they are living out. They are living out before other people the newness of life.
Yes.
It's so radically different from this world that there are people that will inquire about the hope that's as within you. Well, why do you live that way? Then you give an answer for the hope that's within you. But you have to be ready to do this now.
Yeah.
You can't say, well, here's what we believe.
Yeah.
That's
right, yeah.
We're looking for someone who's been there and knows. You remember Jesus said that there were people he was going to say this to. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say?
Yeah.
All right, how does the person propose to answer that question? Because people that have been exposed to what Jesus said but haven't done it, this question is going to be asked.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Why did you call me Lord, Lord, and didn't do what I said?
Yeah.
I tell you, there's no acceptable answer to that question. He that does not honor the Son, Jesus said, does not honor the Father.
Mm-hmm.
So their pretense about loving God, wanting to serve God, and all this is just a lot of talk.
Mm-hmm.
It's not true. They don't honor the Father. James said to Christian people, he said this. He said this to Christian people.
Mm-hmm.
The book of James was written to a bunch of rebels. This is what he said to you, adulterers and adulteresses.
Coming,
envision this like being read Sunday morning to a congregation. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship with the world is enmity with God?
Mm-hmm.
Whosoever wants to be a friend of the world is the enemy of God.
That's right. Yep.
Now you take Jesus out of the scenario and there's no answer to that.
Yeah.
But the church has got to come across. They got to dump all these other programs they're engaged in. Dump all their specialized ministers. This is just stuff that's got to be sloughed off. Slough it off and get to the point where you can bring people to Christ.
Amen.
If you can get them to Jesus,
yeah,
the thing will be ironed out. And they'll stay with Jesus. The thing will be ironed out.
Yeah.
You know, those Greeks said to Philip, we would see Jesus. He took them to Jesus.
Yeah.
He didn't say, well, let me tell you. I know a few things about Jesus. Let me tell you what I know about Jesus. He took them to Jesus.
Yeah.
So there's nothing wrong with telling them what you know, but if you got to get them to Jesus somewhere. And the only way is by the gospel, which is the record God has given of his son, 1 John 5:10. So the Jesus we're talking about is the Jesus that God has presented in the gospel. It's the record God has given of his son. All other Jesuses are imposters. They're called another Jesus or a false Christ. They're not the real one. It's the one God has testified of. A failure to respond to this, to honor the Son, is a failure to honor the Father.
Yeah.
And that makes the person God's enemy.
Mm-hmm.
The Father has sent Jesus. He sent the Son into the world as that a solution to sin could be realized.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, the world had been here for 4,000 years at that time.
Yeah.
Nobody had found a solution. We had 2,500 years without law, right, from Adam to Noah, to Moses, 2,500 years. Nobody could come up with a solution. So they tell us, historians and archaeologists and all this, tell us that the smartest people lived back then. That's right. That's where they discovered medicine and mathematics and astronomy and all the sciences. They were discovered back there, and people today are just building on what was discovered back there. But with all their discoveries, they had eye surgery, brain surgery. They couldn't find God.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
He gave them time.
Yeah.
2,500 years without law, 1,500 years with law. If being told what to do, if that's where the answer is, God told him what to do.
Yeah.
Told him what day to honor, what days not to honor, how to plow your field, how to plant your seed, how to sow your garments. See, he told him step by step everything to do, when to have a feast, and every feast was a religious feast. Any holiday was a holy day to the Jews. But it didn't change anybody. God's showing. I must supply the remedy or there will be none.
That's right, yes.
And I'm doing it through my son. I've appointed all judgment to him. He, first of all, he did what had to be done. Sin had to be taken away. The devil had to be destroyed. Principalities and powers had to be plundered. Death had to be overcome. A way had to be opened up that people could get to God through it. Jesus did all that. See, he did all that. And not to honor that work by coming to Christ is not to honor God who sent him. And in closing, there's a lot said about God sending Jesus. Jesus said he didn't send him into the world to condemn the world. He's already condemned.
Yeah.
But that the world through him might be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Peter said the Father sent the Son. He sent him to bless you in turning away everyone from his iniquities.
Yes.
How's that? That's a blessing,
yes,
isn't it?
Amen.
Yeah, but you're meeting with a bunch of what they call addicts. So why not tell them, God sent Jesus to bless you and turning you away from this. We don't have a methodology.
Yeah.
We have life.
Yeah.
Paul wrote that God sent his son to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. So God's intent was to get some sons. John wrote, God sent his only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. That is, live toward God. that is have some response to God, be able to receive from God. That's why he sent Jesus into the world. He sent his son, loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for sin, the covering. Mm-hmm. So that he took a sin away so much so that God couldn't see your sin anymore. And again, we have seen it do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world.
Yeah. Amen.
And then the record God has given of His Son, which is contained in seed form in the Gospels, mm-hmm. and then it's expounded in the Epistles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In the Epistles, it's the Gospel that is expounded.
Yeah.
The Epistles tell you why Jesus died, what happened when He died.
Uh-huh.
That's not in the Gospels. A few hints, but it's expounded.
Yeah.
And the fact that you can personally participate in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ.
Yeah.
You're buried by baptism into death. You're not buried because you're dead. Now, I was taught this when I was a child. That only you bury what's dead, but that's not it's not the kind of thing baptism is.
Right.
You bury so it can become dead. We are baptized into his death. Why? Because that's the only death God will raise you from.
Amen. Yeah. That's right.
Yes. If you're united with Christ's death, God can raise you from the dead to walk in newness of life.
Yes.
If you're just buried, and I'm afraid, I'm not going to sit in judgment on this, but I suspect that a lot of baptisms were just dunkings. If that isn't the case, then it's very difficult to explain the products.
Yes. Yeah.
Very difficult. So you see why God insisted all men honor the Son. That all men,
yeah.
that all men, God's given judgment, all judgment to the Son, that all men should honor the Son as they do the Father. That is, they'll see the Son as the way to the Father. They'll see the Son as the means of obtaining mm-hmm. what the Father has to give. And when you do that, you'll not be condemned.
Amen. Amen.
You'll not. You'll be able to stand boldly on the day of judgment. Because
yes.
what you couldn't do, Jesus did do.
Mm-hmm.
And what you need to do, he'll empower you to do.
Yeah.
So we can't offer anything better than that.
That's right.
See, we got a good salvation, people. We got a good salvation.
Yes.
Praise God for it. And if you have another word, any other word to add before we close here? All right. You're going to lead us, Sister Tasha? We're going to enter into a time of prayer now.